afternoon and welcome to lecture on Nobel Prize. We are there to have been organizing the lecture on Nobel Prize since the year 2009, this is the 10th edition. The idea is simple. Typically, Nobel Prizes are viewed as one of the ultimate achievements for scientists. And the areas are so specialized, we often don't understand what it is. So we actually request subjects who have the expertise in the relevant area to tell us like a cafe in Dover, what is it they did to deserve this prize, which is the objective. And typically people are very sharp. The fear is that if you give them more can you make it very difficult. We all have to go out, so that is the idea. In addition, individual departments do organize more technical details. For example, last week physics had organized close to an hour long talk on the physics model by Professor Roop Malik of KFR and two similar talks in the respective departments also. So, I just want to thank all the four speakers who really agreed to deliver this lecture. We will start in the order in alphabetical of the place category. The first one is chemistry. Request Kiran to tell us about what is the question to do the model.
So I'm going to tell you about why these three people won the Nobel Prize in chemistry. So to begin with, 20 minutes is enough for me to make it still technical, but I'll try not to lose it. Anyway, so if you look at this, these three people have very smartly made use of the evolutionary principles to evolve enzymes to go beyond what their normal capabilities are. And so these are the three people who won the Nobel Prize. The first one is Professor Frances Arnold. So she's from Caltech. She won the Nobel Prize. So I'm just quoting it exactly from the Nobel Prize record for the directed evolution of enzymes. And the other two guys, one is from UK, Sir Gregory Whittle, and the second one is Professor Dar Smith. They have also used a different method to evolve novel functionalities and also to discover synthetic antibodies. And if you're interested in how many papers they have published in the center, right? So Professor Frances Arnold and Professor Gregory Whittle, they have about 250 to 260 papers all of course in very good journals. And Professor Dodd Smith, who actually first time discovered this page display, has about 50 papers. So the numbers doesn't really matter, right? Yeah. And she has about 60 patents, and Professor Victor has about 100 patents. To start with this, I just want to take a few minutes to tell you how evolution works. Right? This is what Darwin discovered way back about 150 years ago. So a population, if it has to evolve, one thing it has to have is a large population size. So a larger population size implies that it has all kinds of variation that is built into the population so that it can respond to any changing environment slightly better, right? Which tells you that there are some differential survival, right? Some individuals, some variation in the population, if that responds better, right? And those are the ones who will actually reproduce and their numbers will increase in the next generation, right? This is what Charles Darwin discovered. And probably most of you are familiar with this example, right? So you see here you have a large variation in size, and size is the phenotype that was selected for because all the other guys could not reach for their goal, right? So this is how basically evolution works, and without our knowledge we have been also selecting animals as well as type of food, and this has been going on for more than 2 to 3,000 years. Right? Starting out with this variety of a plant, now by selective breeding we have evolved this modern form within a very short period of time. Right? So with this background, I'll just tell you briefly what she wanted to do. Basically, she's actually a mechanical engineer, and her specialization was in aerospace. So she graduated in 1979, and so she wanted to work on developing some new technology, and her first interest was on developing solar cells. So she dabbled in solar cells for about 2 years. But in 1981, there was a shift in Wisconsin. Right? They thought that so they would focus more on oil, but not so much on solar power and things like that. So she was completely disheartened and started looking at other avenues of making material or chemical by greener methods and sustainable means. And that is why she covered upon enzymes. Because you know, she, in her graduate days, she sat for one or two lectures on enzymes, and she knew that you know all of us are made of enzymes, and these are the ones that give bacteria and all kinds of organisms their metabolic capabilities, right? So initially, she basically wanted to, she selected an enzyme called as cetylysin, which is basically a protease, it chops up other proteins. So she wanted to make this enzyme work in organic solvents, which is not the usual way this enzyme functions, right? They all work in water. So she wanted to change the property completely. And then why? Because she has also understood that, you know, enzymes are very useful. Of course, all these images have taken recently. So this was in way back in 1980s, right? And so she wanted to contribute something for making all these materials and chemicals in a much better way. And when she started out by looking at from a structural point of view. Right? This was also the time when people started to understand how protein would look like at the atomic level. And there were a few structures available. And biologists started, they had understood how a protein structure leads to its function. And then, of course, they were completely wrong. So she spent about 5 years trying to look at the cetylysin and changing just one or two things here and there to see whether you know, she can actually evolve a new function. Of course, she failed. Why she failed? See, this is just an example. If you look at all the bacterial enzymes, right? These are the catalysts, and most of them are about 250 to 300 amino acids in length. And if you see that there are only 20 natural amino acids, and you can have a 250 to 270 amino acid long polypeptide with this many possible combinations. Right? So what people refer to as sequence space because there are a lot of possibilities, but only few of them can give you the desired function. Right? And then when you have such a sequence space, our hypothesis was that you can basically change certain properties and make enzyme do something else. And this is how she started. And she was also worried that if you want to evolve an enzyme for a desired function in a natural setting. Natural setting, we're talking about just bacteria. Poor bacteria. It takes a lot of time. Right? Because the life as we see today started its evolution 2.7 billion years ago. And evolution is not random, but the mutations are random, right? And the only way it works is they respond to a changing environment. Right? So there is no set goal for evolution. So and in other words, in our you know in the time scale of us, right, it is almost impossible to evolve an enzyme in its natural setting. So that is when she thought of going back to the literature, and there was one paper in 1984. It was a hypothetical paper where the first time they thought of actually generating mutants, right, outside of the cell. Now we know that, you know, it is possible by some technology called as polymerase chain reaction, right? You take a small part of your genome, a single gene, and you can basically copy it many times over and over again, and within 2 to 3 hours, you will have about 10 million copies, much more than that, right? So here, they have come up with just 6 steps, right? This was a hypothetical paper. As long as you have the ability to produce templates with those variations, and as long as you have a way to score for its property, right? And then select those clones and go back and re-evolve in a cyclical fashion. They thought that you can pretty much evolve any function. So inspired by this hypothesis, and these guys, they never really talked about, I actually went through this paper, they never really had any clue how to do this experiment. right? So this was the paper she published. So by using a technique called as directed evolution, she was able to make this enzyme work in an organic disorder, right? So this was probably the first and seminal paper that got the Nobel Prize. And this is slightly technical, but this is how the entire technique works. It's also elegant and it's quite simple, right? So as I said, you are starting off with one or few copies of the genes, and then within like 3 to 4 hours by using polymerases, you can, or there are some other methods as well, you can generate a lot of these mutations, right? So in biology, we call DNA, which carries the information, whereas all that information is executed in the form of phenotype, which is the protein, right? It executes the function. So protein is made from DNA, and that all of us know about that. So essentially, you start out with a few copies, and you can make as many as 10 to 15 DNA copies, which will have random mutation. So from that, you can actually make proteins. Most of them probably cannot make protein due to the error in the coding and things like that. But the few you can make to protein, as long as, so long as you can come up with a functional method, right? So now you have the end in mind, right? You want to involve a protein for a specific function. As long as you have a method to score for that function, you are in business. And that is exactly what they did. And so starting out with these many molecules, a very small fraction of them. So this is about 1 in 100 billion, which is good enough, right? They have evolved a new function here, and most of them were thrown out. And then you take this small subset and go through this iteration maybe 3 or 4 times, and you'll end up with a protein, and you end up with a gene that will have the desired properties, right? So this is the technique she has developed, and then it will have all these applications. So this is kind of technical, but I'll just go through this very quickly. So you're starting out with a native enzyme, and it is, nature has optimized it to do a specific function. Now you create random mutagenesis, you increase the population size, you increase the variation, and then this is the bottleneck, right? First thing is you have to evolve a protein that can do a new function. At this point, you are not really worried about the efficiency or how good that protein is for that particular function. But once you have this protein or the gene for that protein, you are in business, right? Within just few generations, you can take that and evolve into that function much better. So if you look at the sequence phase, basically you are shifting a protein from a native function, and you are optimizing. It has to come down. It has to lose its ability to do its basic function, and then you have to evolve it to do a new function. So if you want the bacteria to do this, it will take much more time, and we can do this in no time at all. So this is one specific example. Again, she wanted to make this protease, right? Very stable at, let's say, 65 degrees. So the one they had was not much stable at all. So here they are not looking at changing the catalytic property, but the stability of the protein. So within 5 cycles, you see, this is in log scale. So they ended up with an enzyme that worked as well as the native enzyme, but at much higher temperature, and it was much more stable. Right, so this is what has she contributed, and over the course of next 20-30 years, she worked on a lot of these enzymes. Once she had the technology, right, all she needed was a method for selection. See, method for scoring the phenotype and arriving at the desired function. And her favorite molecule is cytochrome P450. Why? Because this is an enzyme that is present, it has a lot of different functions. And this is present in our liver. See, when you take all these chemicals, right, so these enzymes can actually metabolize them. And they are not really good at metabolizing a specific compound, but they have a very broad spectrum activity. They can take up any kind of chemical, and they have the ability to break them down. Right, so if you are looking at the functional promiscuity, this is an excellent molecule or excellent enzyme to begin with. Right? And now where is she heading? Right? If you look at how she's the boundaries, Now she basically wants to construct some strained carbon cycles. Even people who use chemical catalysts, they have a tough time synthesizing such molecules. So she's evolving enzymes to do such things. And I'll just give you an example of how her technology has helped in reducing the cost of her very well-known diabetes drug. So this drug is called as sitagliptin. You know, this was actually invented by Merck Research Group, and there have been, I think, some of you have been in US for the last 10 years, probably have seen an ad for Genuvia, right? And this is the chemical. And people used to basically make this chemical by using a multi-step, very complicated chemistry using, you know, heavy metal and solvents and things like that. So by adapting this directed evolution method, they just zeroed in on an enzyme called transaminase, and they can now synthesize the same molecule in just one step. Right now, this is greener, cleaner, and they have also evolved to get a lot of this. And you see, very rarely company people publish paper in Nature and Science, right? So this is one of them. You see, Merck Research Laboratories. So they were able to achieve this, and now this is the way they actually make this chemical. Right? This is used to treat. Now, where she is going, right? So, right now she is basically repurposing almost all the enzymes. However, she is starting out with cytochrome P. And now she wants to actually catalyze an enzyme, evolve an enzyme for carbon silicon bond formation. Right? Silicon is an abundant element, but there is no enzyme that actually can do this, right? So she's taking the cytochrome P50 enzyme, and she's trying to evolve such a function, right? So you see here, you can see silicon-based life. I don't know if there are some Star Trek fans here. Probably they know about this. Only in Star Trek you have heard about some organic, you know, some silicon-based organism. So here is an example. And it has a very peculiar life cycle. A lot of these are made, and after 50 years, most of them will die, and only one would survive a decoder, right? This is kind of a clonal propagation. But this is how she's pushing the boundaries, and because each enzyme has incredible sequence space, although the number of functions that it can do is probably limited to a certain space, but that evolution, even in the, you know, in 3.7 years, it never had a chance to explode, right? Because there was no selection for those extremities. And by applying this and by accelerating the evolutionary process and directing for a particular function, so she's able to evolve all of this. And now where all of this is heading, right? So while she's working on evolving an enzyme function, there are other people who are basically trying to evolve an entire biology and trying to change the genetic code itself. Right? And I think most of you know that how our genes are coded and proteins are made, right? We have a triplet codon. So which means that our triplet codon can only take up 20 amino acids. So there are people now in the last 15 years that are trying to evolve a codon that will have 4 nucleotides instead of 3. Right? Suddenly if you have 4, now you can incorporate 256 different amino acids. Right? And people have already shown that one can incorporate more than 60 different amino acids. And this was a hypothetical paper where this cell is basically an E. coli, a bacterial cell, where you are evolving an independent system for making protein of your interest, right? So if you combine this technology with what Professor Francis has done, and if you give her, you know, she with only 20 amino acids, she can do so much of magic. And if you give her another 230 amino acids, what she can do, right? I mean, sky is the limit. A lot of people have taken up this, and now this directed evolution has become a routine laboratory technique. And so I will just stop here and I'll move on to the next one. And so this will now, this partially has been achieved, but probably in the next 5 to 10 years, this will become a reality. Okay, so now moving on to the next, right? The other two guys actually got the Nobel Prize for a slightly different technology. This is based on using a bacteriophage. So bacteriophages are basically viruses that infect specifically bacteria. They are not harmful to us, right? So, and if you look at bacteriophages, they come in, they are really, really small. For example, if you look at bacteriophage T4, this is the scale of about 0.2 microns, 200 nanometers. And M13 phage is also quite small. And in 1985, what Professor Smith did was to use this M13 phage, and he developed a way to display a protein or a small part of the protein so that we can study protein interaction. So I'll briefly tell you how he has done. So if you look at an electron microscope, this is how this M13 phage looks like. You know, this is about 2000 nanometer or 2 micrometer in length, whereas it has a very small diameter of only 7 to 8 nanometers. Right? So very quickly, how does these bacteriophages infect? See, when we talk about human viruses, usually the entire virus gets in and they cause havoc in our cells, right? But in the case of bacteriophages, they never get in. They just inject their DNA and then the DNA is copied and all the proteins are made using the host machinery, and then the fully assembled virus would come out. So for each infection, on an average, they produce about 300 to 1000 new particles. And especially if you are looking at a bacterial infecting viruses, they can do it very quickly within a time scale of about 20 minutes. Right? And this is the power of evolution that Professor Smith made use of. Right? So it is very, very simple. These bacteriophages carry very, very few genes, about 8 to 10 genes that are required for their survival. Right? So now this was in 1980s, and these viruses were studied from 1940s, and by then we had a fair understanding of how this entire virus works at the molecular level. So, and also by then there was all these techniques of genetic manipulation, recombinant DNA technology were all there. So basically they figured out if they insert a small gene between one of the genes that actually is responsible for making a protein that is expressed on the virus, right? You can basically display this peptide that is coming from this gene, right? So when you have a virus displaying a protein, it can basically use another protein, in this case what is shown is antibody, right, to fish out specific interactors. So this is a very elegant technique, because if you look at most of our biology, right, whether it is DNA replication or how the proteins are made, a lot of proteins have to come together in unison and then only they can function. Even how these antibodies work, right, in our body, they basically have to. Yeah, so this was the paper they published in 1990, right? And yeah, so if you look at viruses, these antibodies are floating around in our blood. As soon as they see a foreign protein or a foreign body, a virus or a bacteria, they just go and bind to them and it inactivates them, right? So, and then Professor Winter, Gregory Winter, what he did, he just switched the way Professor Smith has developed his technology. So instead of having a peptide on top of these bacteriophages, he displayed a library of antibodies. So if you have a library of antibodies on top of this page, now you can basically screen against a protein of your choice. And you can basically isolate one of the highly specific interactors, right? And this is the technology he used, and rest of the things they were basically the same way. So he would also start with more than 100 million copies of these pages, displaying a lot of different protein or peptides, and only few would depict because they can, some way they can interact with the protein, right? And if you do this process for 3 or 4 generations, you would end up with a peptide that will have very, very, very high specificity, So it means that this peptide, which is actually coming from an antibody, can only interact with this protein and nothing else. Which is a requirement if you want to use that for treating immunodeficiency, right? And this is the Humira, right? Probably many of you have heard about this name if you are in US in the last few years. So this is one of the most commercially successful, biopharmaceuticals. And this was commercialized in 2002 and patent expired, I think, 2 years ago. So in the 14 years, this actually company started by Professor Smith, and it has generated a revenue of more than $20 billion. So among the three, probably he is the only billionaire. Right? So how does this work? Basically, this antibody they have generated by using this phage display technology against a protein called as TNF-alpha. When you have elevated level of this tumor necrosis factor, it causes inflammation, it causes rheumatoid arthritis. So when you have an antibody that can actually go and fish out these TNF-alpha, these proteins that are floating in the blood, and take it out of circulation, then you are not inflamed, right? It's a very simple, very elegant method. And this is exactly how they did. So they have also used error-prone PCR. They started out with a small part of the antibody, a gene for a small part of the antibody, and then they amplified this. They put it on the top of this bacterial genus, and then they fished out some variants that interacted very closely with the TNF alpha. Right? And this is how they have developed this compound. So I will just stop here, and to sum it up, right? What they have done is they developed two very simple, very elegant technologies by using Darwinian principles. And this is one of the very nice examples of how your basic research, helps you, in developing products for our own use. If you have any questions, you can ask me. Thank you.
Since the evolution is very slow, with time we can expect more number of amino acids generated?
So, yes, evolution is very slow, but the more number of amino acids, the way evolution works is, it works on the basis of the need, right? What is the immediate requirement? You have all these variation that is present, and out of which there is some selection, some pressure from the environment. Only the ones, the individual that responds slightly better are selected. So, if there is a need for, invention of a new amino acid, it would happen. In fact, people have already discovered two new amino acids that are now considered as natural, right? One is pyrrolizine. Yeah. But those are also very rare. They are not abundant, and those are more like outliers. Yeah. So this optimization of codon to amino acid, people think that it has it has happened in a very different way. And probably it is still evolving, but we are looking at only our time scale. So yeah, probably it is still possible. So people are looking at some extreme files, where there is some change in how the codons are used or some unusual amino acids are incorporated.
Thank you.
Any other question? Okay, thank you, Kiran. A small token of our appreciation. The next prize category is economics. Already discovered, but it's a Nobel Prize. It is economics, and the speaker is Professor K. Narayanan from the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences.
I have to be proud of the to speak on this Nobel work. The position is, working in the area of innovation as well as climate change for the greater range, that's more of so the two Nobel laureates in economics. You will see speeches and others in this presentation. Basically, one is a familiar name to many in our areas yet, because the name of God was the father of Paul Samuelson, who was more clear than the name of Jesus, which is one of the ways. And from here, was Paul Roma, who is the name, the way you start to go to the name of God. Now, on the Nobel Prize, they come to term, as the colony pointed out, people talk about the words, as many call the world or not, but I want to quote here, the script of this. So I wanted to quote Michael Nell, who said that economics has some fleeting effects on society and the other disciplines, and can therefore be considered a problem. The really concept, I think, from scientific progress to natural peace. So it's about understanding and gaining the basis for engineering and development. It's also a kind of equal. So what is their contribution? Basically, you know, Lawrence was the first person to create a quantitative model that described the interplay between ecology and climate. Very often we talk about climate change, but he started talking about developing a model which can account for climate change impacts on the economic world itself in the 1980s. And Paul Romer also worked on how the economy can grow, but he talked about more about the readiness of homes to produce new ideas and innovations, and thereby laying the foundation for a new model of development, and which later on became extremely popular at the energy level. Before that, by and large, foundation was growth. So both the researchers began their work based on another own work by Robert Solow. Particularly for his work, Solow was very well known. He keeps that Solow model here, a theory of economic growth that terminated the exogenous growth. So Solow was well known in 1987 for his contribution, and is popularly known as the new Keynesian of those years. So, but the difference here is the pathways adopted by Romer and Mernes were quite different, although they are trying to come to some answers towards how to stimulate economic growth in different contexts. So, the context, what are the pathways? Basically, both are together, as the Romer citation says, that they are trying to integrate two aspects, one on innovation, other on climate, and trying to see how we can integrate economic growth. So, as we all know, at the heart, economic deals basically with scarce resources. If the resources are not scarce, then subject matter economics is available. Okay, and by and large, nature dictates the main constraints of economic growth, and our knowledge limits or determines how exactly we deal with these constraints. So, these two people's work can together be taken to understand how to overcome these constraints. So, this year's winners have significantly broadened the scope of economic analysis by considering models that explain how the market economy impacted the nature of the economy. So that's where their contribution to the nature is. Now, both begin by talking about the profit of the market. In fact, they don't talk about profit certainty at all. So that's again another very interesting element. Both began in the early work, instead they talked about imperfections. And they say that there are spillover effects. In fact, we talk about the proportionality in our courses. And so basically we say that either a new technology, wherever it originates, can be used for production or development of new ideas elsewhere, or a newly emitted unit of carbon, whatever its origin, quickly diffuses in the atmosphere and contributes to climate change, again affecting all humanity now and also in the future. So both basically deal with the current as well as future, but both also finally are talking about the problem of externality. So their externalities are to get the consequences for others that are not taken into account by the individual innovation of the religions. So what is the way out? So they're saying if you have dealt with such externalities, if you leave the market to be unregulated, then you cannot find a proper solution. So the resource allocation will not be suboptimal. So as a result, they're saying that it's important that modern intervention is reform to correct from these analyses, and then how exactly it goes about. So then we start talking about this. Now, but I wouldn't be able to talk about these two growth models without being a list of technically Robert Solow's growth model, which is very well celebrated and highly encouraged in various markets. So in a resource constrained economy where you talk about consumption and investment determining the total output,
Again, it's about Bhagavad Gita, where Soro basically says, not only this world is only a question of capital labor, but also a time period T, which represents changes in production possibilities, especially improvements due to technology change over time. So that's exactly how we are saying. But the difference here is, we talk about T being exogenous to the system. The important assumption that Soro had made earlier was that the exogenity of the technical problem. Okay, so therefore the primary talks about capital accumulation as well as labor accumulation, bring about technical change as well as in terms of the level of system. So he talks more and more about capital accumulation, why it is important for different economies to invest more, you know, to increase the capital stock, so it is net addition to the capital formation, or net addition to the capital stock, which we call it as capital formation, which can really determine the rate of progress in the economy. So even if you take a simple utility function, where which is an discount factor, basically we talk about accounting for all the utilities that we derive from now as well as from future utilities and values, how exactly the economy can go around with this will work out quite well. So, his solution basically is the optimization version. So, it is basically also looking for the optimal savings problem. So, the economy that is able to save more is the one which is able to grow more. A model that is largely believed and followed in a number of Asian countries, also like South Korea and others, who all emphasize on high savings rate in the 1970s and 80s, where they said this is exactly how the economy can grow. So they talk about 30%, 40% savings rate of GDP so that the economy can grow, because they can get automatically invested. But Soro, the important contribution comes in the following, where he makes some predictions based on a very simple prediction function for the test, where he says, the indigenous savings can be summarized in the form of a mathematical equation. And given this constraint, what he tries to say here is the growth rate can actually be determined by high levels of savings, which in turn trigger high rates of investment, etc. But this Soro's model is also has some limitation. Empirically, when people look at different countries' performance, find that different countries are growing at different rates. Now China and India are growing at much higher rate than several of the economies. But we find low income countries, the difference between high and low income countries are very high. When low income countries are able to grow at a much higher rate. Also, low income countries have high growth rate when compared to one of themselves also. Not all low income countries are able to grow at high rates. So, no one felt the need that we need to relook into the solar model and see how such persistent and significant growth rate differences is crucially, critically important and also start looking for a so, what is Omar trying to say? How is it different from Soro? So, according to Soro, technology simply arises from what is not called the black box, from outside, globe, developed somewhere else. But a major breakthrough of Omar's achievement was to open the black box and show how ideas for new goods and services produced by new technologies can be created in the market economy itself. And he also demonstrated here how such endogenous technological change can shape growth and what in the policies that are necessary for this process. So, Roma's contribution had a massive impact on the field of economics. Several people have worked in this area. This theoretical expression laid the foundation for research on endogenous growth as well as debates were attended by country-wise growth comparisons having ignited new and vibrant entities of research around the world. So, according to Roma, technological change is how knowledge can function as a driver of long-term growth. And he says that annual economic growth of a few percent accumulates over decades, it transforms people's lives. So, previous macroeconomic research is actually talking about innovation as primary driver of economic growth, but I don't model how economizations and market conditions determine the creation of new technology. The goal of solving the problem of the world is how economic growth governs this. The legal support in the reasonable ideas. So we take a quick look at Omar's solution to this. First published in 1990, which laid the foundation of what is now called the endogenous growth theory, which is again very well taught in most developed economics courses. The theory is both conceptual as well as practical, because it explains how ideas are different to each other, or to are different to other goods and require specific conditions to thrive in the market. And he also generated a vast amount of new research units on policy. So, how does it bring about endogenous technical change? So, typically, in a planner talks about maximizing the
Bhagavad Gita talks about maximizing everything. I have seen Bhagavad Gita. We are not restricted to any part of the Bhagavad Gita. So, when the Bhagavad Gita social planner would solve the life solving problem, something that was saying, and also in terms of this, then we talk about the growth making the one. Is talking in terms of all the exogenous technological change is basically factored in. And it is that which was 18 plus 1 minus 18. That basically is talking about all the overview of that, how exactly the changes are taking place. So, what is the difference? The difference basically says that the growth rate A, namely, is analogous to the exogenous rate of gamma and solar model. But here, the this particular expression is talking about growth rate is actually exogenous. So, it is choice of, it is a result of the choice, the traits of the use of workers in manual production against the use of research and ideas production. So, people in this economy will have a choice whether to work in manufacturing or to work in knowledge industry, to contribute towards further know-how for development of new processes or products, etc. So, he goes on to explain this that if you leave it to the market to do the R&D, market will definitely take care, but it might lead to, it may lead to a situation where workers make a conscious choice. But you have to allow the power, even in the commodity market. You may have to go one step forward beyond the commodity market, allow the power to charge, to have a market, markup price over the marginal cost, so that they can afford to profit some amount of money. Otherwise, they won't be incentive for that. So, when you do that, Roma's basically trying to say that with free entry, with what the population assumes, that the growth rate will actually take that into account. It will be steady state and sustainable. So, the significance of the contribution of robot here is how ideas are different to goods, such as physical or chemical. That's the distinction he makes as against solo and others. So, Roma's research showed how liability and exclusivity of ideas become economical. So, there could be a possibility of liability here. Exclusivity as well as rivalryness in consumption, as we talk in terms of the non-public goods. But Roma makes a distinction that how we can make it a public good, how we can make it a social good, so that it will be possible for us to achieve much larger benefits than what firms are trying to do in terms of their know-how itself. So Roma also showed that growth driven by accumulation of ideas, unlike growth driven by accumulation of physical capital, does not have the experience you face in the country. That's one of the major concerns that we face, that many of the production functions that we find use, capital has, once it starts, we start using capital machinery, then the increasing will start saying either tomorrow or the after. So ideas do economic growth can be sustained over a period of time is the contribution. So he explains this in a simple two-box diagram where he starts thinking in terms of the commodities. So he says the commodities which have rival goods, which are non-rival commodity. So a can of soft drink is actually rival because one is available, or a bottle of water that is available to me is not available to you. It's rival, private commodity. Again, a television channel which I only have at home can see, but others, unless you have a television, you cannot necessarily see, etc. Or, whereas fish in deep oceans would be accessible to people everybody who like to fish. In the case of non-rival goods, so the degree of control of exclusivity varies across the world. That's the first point that I basically say. But if you can make a non-rival commodity, say for example a GPS signal or basic RMD, the Pythagorean theorem that was developed and people are using it, etc., widely, and make this knowledge available in public domain, then the economy can use this knowledge, and several economies can use this knowledge, everyone can try to build on the know-how so that they can make products or processes that are more conducive for fostering their growth. So that's exactly the argument that he tried to make. How we distinguish the rival and non-rival goods will also in terms of the degree to which they can be done. So what the policy intervention that Roma basically tries to say is if you leave the market unregulated, we will produce technological change. But the unproductive R&D will tend to be underprovide R&D because for the new goods created to pay. Especially partners where you will see seek some or make some monopoly profits. So addressing this underprovision requires a well-designed government intervention. Because it may not also, those R&D may not also be on the desirable line that the economy or society would require, as in the case of, say, cancer drugs and others, research on cancer drugs and others. So Roma's addressing this other question, he says the government intervention is already required. So we cannot say that we have set up all the CSI and laboratories and others basically to address this. I'm just saying that that's not, I'm not giving that as an example at all. But I'm basically trying to say where public permission or public support to such other people, as in the case of Japan, for instance, where they allow the Bangladesh to come together and government facilitates our reaction. So that we know how to share with all of them become global players, would be a very good model for instance. So Roma's answer says that such policies are vital to run the globe, not just within a country, but also globally. So, for instance, he's talking about reciprocity and laws here. The law should strike the right balance between motivation to create new ideas, otherwise nobody will create new ideas, by giving some monopoly rights to developers, but also the ability to others to use it, by limiting these rights in time as well as in space. That's where Roma's contribution is extremely significant. And that's, if that is in place, then the know-how or ideas creation can lead to and speed up the process of recovery both in several countries, both developed as well as developed. Now, coming to Norvas, who looks at very often we look at climate change as exogenous. But Norvas says that we can try to model climate change and then see how we try to make some endogenous decision in order to account for such change also. Because we also are aware, although we don't accept that climate change is also a global change. So therefore, such human activities are also definitely need to be talked about here. So Rodas decided to work on this topic in 1970s because, you know, he basically says the society in nature is always a possible conflict. And people are more and more worried about, you know, about the growth of combustion of fossil fuel resulting in warmer climates in different parts. So in mid-1990s, he became the first person to create an integrated assessment model, which is very widely used. Most importantly, the IPCC, the Environmental Panel on Climate Change, has acknowledged that and widely uses the integrated assessment model. So his model basically tries to integrate theories and ethical research from physics, chemistry, as well as economics. So he doesn't need only with economics. He basically says that now you take input from other two important sciences as well. So his model is now widely spread and is used to stimulate how economy and climate can co-evolve. And it is used to examine the consequences of climate policy interventions. For example, the carbon taxes. So I want to explain how the integrated assessment model works. So the carbon circulation, following again, the Rodas also begins from solar power. Or macroeconomic laws. Very nice to begin, account for climate change in that. So the carbon circulation model can be modeled according to him as a linear cost-driven system with a time step of 1 year. Where every seven element vector encompasses the size of the seven carbon reservoirs. And D is 11 to 7 matrix of four coefficients. And the diagonal D tells us how much carbon in each reservoir stays in that reservoir. And the element in each column basically has to be E, which ET basically is from the emissions here. So that's the information system that we are basically trying to have. He falls back on what is called Arrhenius formula. The Arrhenius formula, as talked about, in Google, the time to learn, it was first written in 1889. It says that for any commercial, any common chemical reaction that room temperature, the reaction is doubles for every 20 temperature increase in temperature. So, it is that formulation that we basically try to do. So, it measures the direct effect of CO2 emission on the energy budget and is basically given by this particular formula. So, we say the change in energy budget here. Measures in power per area is proportional to the natural logarithm of the ratio between the actual and baseline of the CO2. It also measures all the energy content changes in the normal CO2 concentration. So you can basically account for when the various CO2 levels, how much you have to spend in terms of what will be your energy multiply. Because that means so much money is taken away for individual inputs, which is not available for your capital accumulation and for investment in R&D and others. So, Rodas' formulation using this know-how, it says it's a set of Littles equation for global mean surface temperature and ocean temperature, both expressed as deviations from the pre-industrial level. So, it goes back to global levels and then let's see how interactive that change. So, the system like this, that's why they still talk about pre-industrial level today. When you talk about 1.5 or 2 degrees Celsius, no matter whether acceptable, then they're trying to have this consensus. They talk about pre-industrial level. in the first degree in this level only. So this is not an equation or a linear approximation of the pre-industrial steady state of knowledge system based on the law of nature that energy does not disappear. So basically you have to look at the entropy law, etc. So he comes up with dynamic as well as region-specific models. So dynamic is called dynamic integrated climate economy energy project is called the model. So we talk about changes in over a period of time. So here the term, you want to draw your attention to this term. Basically describe the energy budget of the atmosphere and upper layer of the ocean. So where FE measures the addition of energy due to CO2 greenhouse effect, and OG includes the other man-made additions including methane and aerosol emission, and KTT quantifies the fact that warmer body radiates more energy. Now he brings in carbon circulation to this linear system where you talk both rice as well as dice. Where he talks about it's a dynamic evolution of the emitted CO2. So the variables MT, MTU, and MTL measure the mass carbon in the atmosphere, in the biosphere, and the upper layers of ocean, respectively. So it happens for all the atmospheres and all these levels. So where he talks about net carbon from the atmosphere to the upper reservoir, then he also talks about the net flow to the deep ocean from the biosphere and upper layers of the ocean. And also from carbon to atmosphere to lower. So he's basically what he's trying to do is calibrating his parameters to make it behave in line with the state of the art carbon circulation model. And economists have been working on that. He also goes on to estimate what is called the damage function that he could have had on the economy and the around the nature delivery of the economy. So he describes how much the society loses as a result of global warming with less resources for consumption as well as for investment. That's where he tries to open people's eyes and then say, please try to understand this as well. So the economic models of rice and rice are based on solar models in the popular savings. The difference being that the rice model would consist of 8 regions, of course, I'll come to that. The rice model consists of 8 regions, US, Asian, Europe, other high income, Russia and East Europe, middle income, as well as low middle income, and China and America. We have it for all these 8 regions. So connecting the solar model, we go back to the solar wealth system where LJT is the region's population guarantee and T is the per capita consumption. So when consumers maximize utility by choosing how much to save and consume, taking prices as given, so in a competitive market, what happens here is we expect the firms in those system also to follow a production function. Again, he assumes a problem of production function where you talk about every firm tries to maximize both factor productivity. The net damage function is also accounted for in this total factor productivity. So how exactly disturbs or adversely affects the factor. So the amount of energy services per unit of carbon emission are also factored in this particular behavior of firm itself. So he brings in the discovered trade, as I mentioned earlier, and then he calls this expression P into the model of data is the welfare discount rate. And that's what he says because of climate change. And how do we address this easy concern? So he basically comes up with four possibilities. One, the business as usual. So if you don't talk about any reduction in global warming, and then basically allow this to take place, then it will be more. So if you like to talk about the Nicholas, follow the Nicholas Stern model of conventional temperature or temperature 2.5, then you reduce it by 2.5. How will that be? This is the dark line and the stern one. And then what is the optimal that is actually feasible to achieve? That also you basically try to say over a period of time until 2100. This is exactly what the reference period accepted by most economies, most governments, and thereby given to people working on climate change. And then see how exactly what should be, how will we assess vulnerability to climate change, and how we talk about adaptation to climate change is exactly what we are also working on in high warming. And we are coming into the Government of India since 2002, continuous work that we do on the platform 1 and control currently, also on platform 2 or platform 3, the thermal organization. Now, so what one important caveat I must make about global warming, there are two versions of global warming, and he himself admits that. Basically, when he says the rice model is a regional integrated climate model, in which the economic growth model has 8 separate regions. and simplified dynamic integrated climate economy model, where the model has a single region within a particular region or across world. So, RODA's integrated assessment model can be used to simulate the consequences of business and social policies or those of various policy interventions. And models are also helpful in evaluating how to guide the market economy towards emission levels, the property balance, society cost, as well as benefits. But the question cannot be addressed, this question cannot be addressed within a model, without a model in which, as in realities, the humans are affected by the climate at the same time as climate is affected by the human climate. So how do you basically understand? That means you have to really go into the details of every human activity, including the sector composition of GDP, including choice of your investment outlays and several others. Are you ready to have a negotiation on that? Is every economy, every economic balance of different countries is willing to sit on board and talk about what is going to be the ideal growth path for the world economies? That basically makes it very difficult. As a result, Noda says the limitations largely come from uncertainties. What is uncertainty? Because first thing, you have to be convinced that there will be a possible climate change. People are debating about whether for climate change or climate variability. Even in the climate science center, we are also talking about the same thing here. So, in both natural sciences as well as social sciences, there are uncertainties about many aspects of climate change. For example, we do not know exactly how sensitive the climate is to greenhouse gas emissions, or how great the risk of these are passing global tipping points beyond which the climate may spiral out of control. It's still being researched on, so there's no concluding reasons. It's become highly controversial also to talk about it. Similarly, we also have public knowledge, we have incomplete knowledge about how the economic and human damages caused by climate change and about the cost of decarbonization. Because when you talk about damage estimation, it varies whether you're talking about damage estimation of the resources or you're talking about damage estimation of humans. Because we don't include value to the loss of human life, for example, if that happens because of global warming and others. So the IAF developed by DODA as a model cannot eliminate this uncertainty, which is not damage. But this model can analyze how the appropriate pricing of carbon is affected by different possibilities, such as higher climate sensitive or the higher probability of dangerous global tipping point beyond global warming, as we are aware of. So therefore, what he recommends here is DODA's research most efficient remedy for the problem caused by greenhouse gas emission would be a global scheme of carbon taxes, not just for a particular country. So, which is uniformly imposed on all countries. So, it goes back to people of 1930s and then say maybe what we should go, perhaps we should think of introducing is a societal cost of damage, cost of emission by appropriate tax, we call it pre-premium tax. The carbon tax may be introduced widely across that. But he's saying that in a global emission trading system can do the same job applied to the carbon tax. Provided that limits on emissions are set too low or low enough to result in high growth price for high enough for a price for the carbon. Now we know that we have fell apart. And we have the also agreement on sustainable development goals now, and people are going back on that. So therefore, it's widely debated. But he says they are all part of his recommendations based on this research. So therefore, now to sum up, the contribution of all over in building on us are methodological, providing us the fundamental insights in the concept of economic innovation and climate change. So they do not deliver conclusive answers. That's also something they themselves are very trying to say. But the findings have brought us considerably closer to answering the question of how we can achieve sustained as well as sustainable global economic growth. That's where we go to this hand. So, what is the takeaway for us? Robust work helps us to design institutions and policies that can enhance human prosperity by fostering the right management of the whereas, robust tools allows us to simulate how the economy and climate would co-evolve in the future. In the future, understand under alternative assumptions about the working of nature and the market economy, including the relevant policies. So, basically, it more addresses about the desirability of different global scenarios and specific policy interventions. That's where we stand. Thank you for your attention.
A corollary of robust theory is that we should be multiplying the engineering institutions.
We are doing it with gusto in India. 1.6 million outcome every year. How much good has it done for the economy?
So, I would like to say that I think the important that indigenous technologists and economists are going to try to work together. I think that would be a better solution than what is going on in the solution. If you want to come up with solutions for sustaining growth, I'm asking that question.
I have two questions. One is one of the noble ideas driven growth is sustainable. How can you quantify ideas? Unless you quantify, how can you tell it is sustainable?
That's where the challenge lies. In fact, he'd like to say how it can be endogenous with system, because the later economists worked out, especially the evolutionary economists, Richard Nelson and Sidney Winter, actually said how the idea generation is a continuous process, it's not one off activity. And the continuous improvement, improvisation or not, the language that we understand is technological trajectories that we keep on developing on even a given parallel, will basically contribute to cost efficiency. So that's why we talk about that. That's why we talk about that. Cost efficiency and improved productivity.
The second question is about carbon tax.
Yeah.
He suggests to past or future or both?
No, he's talking about current, so that he can also take care of future. He's not talking about past.
Because in some countries have countries have contributed more in the past, that is why we have problem.
Understandable. But there people said they say that is make a meaning and start taxing so that we go run into serious issues.
That is also another way of controlling developing countries' economy.
Yeah, it's a political question.
So thank you, Prof.
Thank you.
I just have a small and I will request Professor Kalinda Vasa from our Department of Physics to tell us about it.
Briefly discuss the robotizing project. And I thank Prof. Balaji for giving this opportunity and also the other IRCC member. These times, Nobel Prize in Physics is very special for several reasons. One thing is that it has been awarded for developing a tool based on laser. Now, this is quite or relatively less usual in physics because the Nobel Prize is more given for some theory to understand a physical process or some experimental verification of some theory or which actually explains how the universe functions. But this time the Nobel Prize is completely on a technology based inventions. Secondly, it has also honored a woman researcher, which in physics is very rare. In fact, many of us will be nearly witnessing it this time only, because before this, the Nobel Prize for Physics for a woman researcher was more than 50 years back. And the Nobel Prize for Physics for woman in experimental physics was more than 100 years back. So this is really a very special occasion. And let's hope that many more will be honored, and it will not take so long, we will be able to witness many more such occasions. Also, it is little special for me because I have got an opportunity to work on both these techniques and really experience it firsthand. So I will briefly discuss how these techniques work. Okay. So to take directly from the Nobel Prize citation. So these both are for groundbreaking inventions in laser physics. The interesting thing is that the basic physics principles on which these techniques rely are really very, very simple. Something that all of us would be learning at a high school level. Okay? So it is really the ingenuity of these people that they put it in a different perspective, and they help many other researchers to access something which was limited to very few people or just very few laboratories. Okay. So one of them is to Arthur Ashkin for using light to manipulate smaller objects. Okay. So this can lead to a such a delicate way of handling objects, then you can either manipulate something very small as atom, or something as delicate as
now given
particle. And the another one is an extreme in a way, because it is a technique that can generate such a strong light field that can cause even a nuclear fusion like it occurs at the center of the sun. Okay? So one technique is such that it is a possibility of using light in such a delicate manner that may not even harm anything. And another one is a technique that generates a light field that is so strong that it is able to even change the atomic structure or cause nuclear fission. So we will see how this works. I will briefly describe some physical principles, but I assure you that this is not something more than what you have really learned in school. Now we all know that waves carry energy and momentum. It's quite simple. If you look, consider sound wave or the water wave, we know that they push around objects, etc. Nothing very surprising. But to see or have the same idea of a light is really difficult because light can propagate any medium to propagate. So when there is no medium to propagate, how it can exert force? However, since light is also a wave, it carries energy and momentum. Of course, there are proofs for this, but one can understand from very simple experience that the light coming from very far off stars, even though very deep, is still sufficiently capable of generating a response in our eyes. If it carries energy, if it carries energy, it also can exert force. Okay. The force is very small compared to the kind of force that water waves would exert, because a fairly powerful reactor of 30 milliwatt will be able to exert force which just a wind can provide. Okay? So the force that light can provide actually is very small, and that too it provides only when it is focused on a very small area. So one would feel that okay, this is then light is not really that powerful. However, it can be extremely useful if you really want to manipulate small objects. Also, the interesting thing is that well, it has very low force that it can provide. But however, one can think of light forces of different intensity. For example, sun as such is extremely powerful light source that even 4 kilometers away you can get sufficient light. Or you can have a very light, deep light source coming from very far off stars. Also, it can cover a very huge range of wavelengths. Okay? So, these two one can make use of to make light work for us. The first one is how you want to exert pressure on an object. Now, pressure, since light has a momentum and rate of change of momentum is going to be force. If you somehow change the momentum of light, then you will be able to get the pressure. But how do you change the momentum of light? Very simple is that you just change its velocity. And that's what you do if you just make light pass from one medium to another. Because of the change in refractive index, the velocity changes and hence it will be able to exert force on that particular object. By adjusting the rays to the object, just transmission, normal refraction, that one gets, one can use this pressure difference or the force to keep the particle at where the maximum intensity is, and that is the focus. Okay. So that is the basic principle of optical tweezers that was given by Arthur Ashkin. Arthur Ashkin, here the main principle is, or the very important principle is, that the light is not really absorbed by the object is really transparent. Okay, the force is exerted only by the change in the velocity of light when it sees the change in the refractive index. There was a in Arthur Ashkin work is Chu, who got a Nobel Prize for tracking atoms using light. It actually way back in 1997. He also used light to track the atoms. But that's a very different principle where actually the light is absorbed by the atoms. Okay? You need a light which is absolutely resonant with atoms, and momentum is transferred by the absorption of water. Here there is no absorption of water. Just go through. However, after asking was, since he got his cue, he was somewhat disappointed that both the techniques use the power of light to manipulate small objects. However, his work was not recognized, whereas other people's work was recognized. But I think that was the time of quantum optics, because all that 10 years of prize was given to our quantum optics along with the world. Okay. So, but here one has to, since this force is anyway going to be very small, we have to really focus the light hard. So the smallest you can go is half the wavelength, so that is the kind of spot one creates and then keeps the particle there. Interestingly, this experimental demonstration is extremely simple. It is well within the reach of any university undergraduate lab. Same way, we have also introduced this experiment in our undergraduate lab. Because it just needs a small laser, just power flare with laser diode pointer, not even low, not power on zero. And then just a microscope objective, it will focus the light. And then something to view, like Arthur Rushkin wants to use, the screen camera, and some sample scale to move around the sample. Okay? So this is quite within the reach of any university lab. And that's where the ingenuity comes, because this principle that light has momentum and it exerts force was known from Kepler's time, so many years back. But to use it for some application which people had really not thought about, that too in 1980s when already the technology was well developed, that's where the, his ingenuity is. And he used this kind of setup to hold yeast cell at a given location just with light for several hours. Okay? And the cells were not damaged because they could even undergo division as a function of time and they were growing. Okay, so you could hold the cell exactly at one location and see it under the microscope for several hours and keep seeing it grow. We also did similar experiment with bacteria. Of course, with this kind of setup that we had, we could not get that cell stability, and we could just trap it for a few minutes. But I will show one video that has been recorded in the undergraduate lab by the student. I think we have a picture of the slides. So here there is one particle which is glowing. That has been trapped using the laser. There will be some other particles which will be moving around, unfortunately you can't see them clearly. But relative to those particles which are moving because of downwind motion, this remains more or less stable. Of course, there are some vibrations because the setup is not vibration isolated. And there was one. Okay, so you see there is another particle here. This is trapped by the, so that's where the laser beam is. The other one also feels the force and is also trying to move close to the focus, because that's where maximum force is, and it's an attractive force. It tries to keep the particle close to the focus. Now that one has also gone inside. You see that other particles were moving quite rapidly compared to that one. You have to again switch off the light, sorry. So, other ones are moving quite rapidly, but this one is moving much slower because it is being held. I mean, we are trying to keep it stationary by applying the laser. Now, you can do more interesting things than what has been tried in the beginning. You see, this was a spherical particle, so there is a symmetry and compared to the focus. Whether there is no particular direction, but if you try to use the elliptical particle, here there is a long rod kind of thing we are trying to track, and then we are changing the polarization. Now, since here there is a dielectric constant is different here and here, The polarization is, the particle is sensitive to the polarization of light also. And if you rotate the polarization, one can also rotate the particle. So you can also impart angular momentum. Okay? If you see the particle is rotating, you cannot see what it is invisible. The laser spot, of course, one has to use the filter, so you cannot see the laser spot. There is nothing touching the particle except the light. And you are still able to impart the angular momentum just by changing the polarization of light. Here we are changing the polarization of light by hand because by changing the wavelet. But instead of this, if one uses circular polarization where the electric field is going in a circle anyway, naturally, the particle will rotate by itself. Okay? So this is how the applications in molecules, waters, etc. are got, where you not only can hold the particle, you can move them around, you can also make them rotate without destroying the molecule. Since the time of Arthur Ashkin, this technique has moved forward to a great extent. As I demonstrated that you can manipulate the polarization and then make the particle spin around its axis, you can use special kind of helical mode and really move the particle in a circle also. So there is a lot of control on the motion or the manipulation of the small objects that one can get. Instead of just being one focus, you can have multiple foci, okay, by special techniques of light modulators and track lots of particles. Here it's a 20 by 20 array. So 20 particles you can track at a time. And by controlling the polarization of each of these spots, you can manipulate them all at the same time. And then the final is the earlier was this Ashkin's disappointment that Drew got the Nobel Prize for tracking atoms and pulling it, but his invention was not considered. It was anyway based on different principles. But now people have shown that you can actually track the cold atoms themselves by manipulating the light gradient that size. Of course, if you just try to focus the light, you cannot do anything rather than half a micron. But the atom is much smaller. But if you use metal nanostructures, the capability of focusing light around them, you can make metal nanostructures all the way down up to 2 nanometers or so. And hence, you can also really track atoms using Arthur Ashkin's principle, not Stevenson's principle where the light is absorbed. However, here, see, it's important to know that this cold atom of EC is stable at a very, very low temperature of nano Kelvin. Okay? If you try to put light, another light, it will destroy the VEC or Bose Einstein condensation in no time because light has atoms. But here, Arthur Ashkin's technique, the light probe is so delicate that it does not destroy the Bose Einstein condensation. So it's the ultimate probe that one can create which will not even disturb the atoms from its position, yet it will hold. Okay. So this is one extreme proposed and developed by Arthur Ashkin and then taken forward by many other researchers. Now I will change gear and go to the other half of the Nobel Prize. Well, that is the exact opposite. Here you talk about very low light intensities and not really disturbing anything. There the intensities are so high that it is sufficient to damage. How do you create such high intensity? The power needed to create, I mean, of course, this is light intensity, so they come, the laser is the origin. But to use the laser continuously for such a large time, there is no way of integrating the intensity. It's just continuously coming. You cannot reach very high intensity just with a continuous laser. Okay? So, you can however, increase the intensity with whatever power, whatever energy you have available. If you push all these in a short burst of time, okay? Because then whatever you have here, very low, but everything just comes out in a short burst. This intensity would go up, shorter the burst This month, however, is another thing, it is the right month. In another, so this is one advantage of going to short months, that one who can reach very high intensity, which is not achievable with the life sources, including with us. But there is another advantage of pulse, that is fast photography. Okay? If you want to take such a picture, drop falling, then means it is creating, etc. How do you make it? These kind of pictures are taken with a flash that remains on for a very short duration of time. So whatever is happening in that duration of time is what you see. So creating a short pulse in principle should let you record something that is occurring on a very short time scale. But how short time scale is more interesting? Means the mechanical time scales are anyway too long for most of the reactions, etc. Because you really want to go to 10 power minus 12, so that is 1 millionth of a millionth or femtosecond, then 1 billionth of 1 million second. So how do you create these pulses? This is kind of time scale. We are here and we want to go 15 orders or maybe shorter, because that's how the camera that one or physicist want would really get you take pictures of how chemical reactions and such are take place. So these since these two aspects about pulse lasers were realized just after the invention of lasers, people had already started working on generating these short pulses. So the development was already there, but the energy of these pulses or the intensity, maximum intensity you could get with these pulses was rather low. Now why so? Even though one could make more powerful lasers, why could not the pulse laser go beyond this? The reason was very simple. Because if you have a pulse, it is already highly intense, and if you try to make it more intense, it will overcome the damage threshold of the lasing material and destroy the laser itself. So there is a self-limiting process. You cannot make pulse laser just by making smaller and smaller pulses, because smaller pulses means higher intensity and ultimately destroy the laser material. So how do you overcome that? That's where the contribution of Dira Guru and Dona Stripen comes. So what they suggested was, okay, you start with a small pulse, not very low energy, low power pulse. It's not going to destroy anything. Then you make it longer in time. If you make longer in time, then anyway that intensity is going to fall. This pulse you amplify in the laser medium. Because the intensity is less, it is not going to destroy the laser medium. Reach whatever power you want, okay? Come out of the laser medium and then compress it back outside in vacuum or in air, then there is nothing to get destroyed. Okay? So this is again a very simple principle that you do not amplify a short pulse. You first make the pulse longer so that the intensities are low, amplify them and then come outside and then compress them back. So why this term short pulse amplification? So, this short pulse, the generation of short pulse needs lots of different colors or lots of different frequencies. They all have to be added in phase. This is how the interference works. Because in interference, you can get more than, if there are two intensities, for this, you just add them to get doubles. But if you interfere them, then you have a possibility of getting four times and elsewhere nothing. So it is just with two sources, but if you do it with large number of sources, at one point you will get very high intensity and other places there is nothing. So that's how a short pulse is generated. The short pulse by definition has lots of colors. For stretching it, you just delay these colors with respect to each other. For example, red comes first and blue comes later. So all these frequencies are now separated. This is like the separation of frequencies is like difference in the frequency in bird song. That is called as chirping. Bird chirping. So here the pulses are churned, means the frequencies are all separated. Then the pulse is amplified. So it's churned pulse that is amplified. And once it comes out, it is again all the frequency components are back in they are synchronized, and then the pulse again becomes small but is much higher error. So hence known as churned pulse interpretation. So this work was done by J.R. Monk and his student Jonas Friedland. The main work was on development of this laser. Okay, this at time it was the only laser in the world at Rochester University, known as tabletop terawatt heat tube laser. But J.R. Monk became little worried that this being a developmental work, and Jonas Friedland may not get PhD in physics. Okay, so they must add some physics part to this laser development, which is necessary to fulfill the requirement. Hence, they tried to do ionization of metal. Okay. Now, of course, if you give energy more than ionization potential, the electron will go out and get ionized. Now, after first, the energy required is quite high, several eV. The laser works at infrared, so that has an energy of only 1 electron volt. Okay? So you cannot, in general, ionize xenon by just 1 electron volt photon, which is an infrared. But this laser is so powerful that you can not only just get first ionization, you can see all the way up to 9th and 10th ionized state of xenon. Okay? So that was the work that Jonas Friedland, here is Jonas Friedland and her other group members who participated in this experiment. But it was good that J.R. Monk was worried about it, because with this he also gave birth to a new, completely new physics of intense field phenomena. Okay? Earlier people had never thought that one could create so much of light intensity and so much of high electric field that one could really ionize that. So with this, their worry, they also gave birth to the new field of intense field phenomena, which is now studied all over the world by the law. So they, J.R. Monk, of course, Jonas Friedland, before starting in PhD, she was not working in this field, but J.R. Monk was more established. He is highly respected and loved in the community of the laser physics. Actually, people were really anticipating that we will get Nobel Prize for his contribution to the development of different types of lasers. Particularly when M.S. Zumel got the Nobel Prize in chemistry for using this time-resolved measurements to understand the reactions. Because the laser that M.S. Zumel used was this term first. So, people were really anticipating that J.R. Monk will get this honor sometime. Of course, apart from this term for simplification, J.R. Monk has, as I mentioned, already contributed to this completely new field of intense field phenomena. He has contributed to many such different fields, and in a way that is pioneering. Traditionally, it is believed that if you want to get a particular color laser, you need a particular material. Hence, your choice is limited. You cannot get a laser of any other, any frequency. And as you go to longer and longer frequency, there are no materials which emit those colors or those frequencies, so you cannot get lasers of them. But J.R. Monk also demonstrated that this, using this high intensity pulses, you can actually generate the entire electromagnetic spectrum. All the way from gamma rays, X-rays, ultraviolet, infrared, visible infrared, and all the way up to terahertz. So this entire electromagnetic spectrum becomes available just by using one laser, but if it has sufficient density. And he, along with Jonas Friedland, they showed how it is done. Okay. Now even if you go to higher frequency, you can make the pulse smaller and smaller and go even to picosecond and really see how the electron clouds change in the other nucleus, etc. So, lot of interesting experiments. within the reach of all researchers. However, there are some multilateral facilities where extremely powerful lasers which can cause nuclear fusion, etc., are housed, and people from all over the world can make use of that. So this is just to summarize. So this was what we did in 80s, which was just the beginning. One person, Arthur Rashkin, showed that okay, there can be a light, it can be as delicate as you want, it will not even disturb atoms from its position, and it can also be made as powerful if you wish, and even create atmospheres of stars on Earth. So, let's thank Dora Streetlight, Jera Moru, as well as Arthur Rashkin for their contribution to this wonderful field. Also for making this field accessible to researchers all over, particularly intense field, because earlier intense field lasers were really a luxury of only some drawings needed for laboratory or something. But with this contribution that Dora Streetlight and Jera Moru has, it has really come well within the reach of at least the research lab of the university. Still, it is not undergraduate lab of the university, but research lab of the university are also able to explore this interesting physics. So with this, I end. And if you want to have some further reading, where there are a lot of online encyclopedia available, where many of these terms or these intense field phenomena, etc., are explained, that you can have a look. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you. We have time for question. Okay, there are no questions. Thank you very much. Just, we have a small token of appreciation for you. Thank you. And, that is category physiology and medicine, and I would request Rahul to tell us about the prize. Rahul is from the Department of Bioscience for Engineering.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you for the balance for the opportunity to give the talk for this novel what they have done at Arnold-Ikiakia. So, this 2018 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine is jointly went to Jim Allison and Prabhu Gomolio for their discovery of cancer therapy by inhibition of negative immune regulation. So in next 15 to 20 minutes, we will learn what is this inhibition of negative immune regulation. Right? So, as of Kyakia in Lomone, so of course they have done a lot of impactful work and very unique. Right? And as impactful that I think of Jack Benjoff, who is chief at Memorial Sloan, the immunotherapeutic, he rightly said, they save an untold number of lives which have been saved by the science that they have pioneered. So that's a very good quote suggesting real impactful work. An untold number, not just thousands which are reported, but there are many more which are unique, because when old world was thinking that if you boost your immune system, you get cure cancer. Because as we all know, the immune system takes care of us, it remains majority of us healthy. But sometimes, whatever the failure of immune defense is, sometimes we become sick, including we get cancer when our immune system doesn't work as it should work. Sometimes it fails. So therefore, everybody was thinking or designing strategies that will boost our immune system. So they were targeting different pathways, giving proteins, giving different things that will boost immune response, but these people think differently. And that's what is the what differently they have been thinking, we will discuss. The little biography about Jim Allison, who is now in the University of Texas, but majority of the work he has done in the Holy Sloan in New York. Kazuo Kogonyo, from Japanese scientist, extremely talented and very well known in the field of immunology, their entire work in Tokyo in Japan. So, come to little basics about the cancer treatment. Majority of you know that cancer is generally treated or known to be treated either by surgery or radiation. But here, caveat is you can use surgery or radiation if the cancer is localized. That means if the cancer is somewhere local, you can remove it surgically. But the problem in the cancer field is that I said it, that means cancer is spread into the body. So, if cancer is spread to different organs, you cannot treat it by surgery, right? So, these are the limitations. Similarly, chemotherapy is generally used in the clinic or widely actually used in our country, especially. Chemotherapy not only targets cancer cells, but also targets normal cells. And therefore, it's very, very harmful. However, immunotherapy, that means targeting the immune system or engineering the immune system to kill cancer, this is unique in the sense it targets mainly the cancer cells and spares our healthy cells. That's why it's gentler to the patient and more targeted and more effective. Right? So, as I said, these traditional cancer therapies, which kills not only the cancer cell, they also kill the healthy cell, especially the chemotherapeutic drugs as well as radiation. Our cancer immunotherapy, it selectively kills cancer cells, but it spares our healthy cells because the immune system is very well known to recognize cell versus non-cell. It knows what is ours and what is not ours, that is cancer cell, it will target only those cells. Right? So, immunotherapy actually was discovered very, very long back, around 1800. And here, William Poole, who was considered father of immunotherapy, he used a very simple technique. In fact, he used some bacteria and he made them kill. He killed the bacteria and injected those bacteria into the tumor of the patient. Very raw method of doing things. But this was early 1890, when the technology was not so sophisticated. He injected simply the Streptococcus pyogenes and Serrated Myrcinus, and he gave it to many different types of cancer patients. He did it sarcoma, carcinoma, melanoma, myeloma, lymphoma, a variety of tumors, right from hematological malignancies to the solid tumor. And in solid tumor, he treated skin cancer, and epithelium and muscle cancer, many cancers he treated, and it was very effective. And he actually was considered father of immunotherapy because, as I said, immune system can fight against cancer. And so this was 1890, but suddenly the good time for immunotherapy was gone because genetics came, and when genetics came, everybody considered cancer is a genetic disorder. Because every cancer, whatever was known or whatever was found, they were having certain mutations. And if you target those mutations, you can treat cancer. But another part of this, you can treat only for short term, they were not long term benefit. But because every tumor, majority of tumor had the mutation or certain genetic alteration, everybody was focusing on the genetics. And then finally, in 1950, almost after several decades, Thomas and Blumenthal, who also got the Nobel Prize, they came up with theory of immune surveillance. And they said that if a person is immune compromised, he develops cancer faster than a normal healthy individual. And that was 1950 when they have proven in the laboratory they were using laboratory animals which were immune compromised. So that means they did not have certain immune components. And when you remove the immune components from a person, and in real-time setting you can think about a person who has undergone transplantation, and that's why that has an immune suppressive drug, so our immune system is not working. Or you can think about a person who is undergoing chronic infection, that means he has a chronic disease, and that's why immune system is not working. So those kind of situations, those individuals who are immune compromised by any means, like AIDS, chronic problems, or by certain defects, by the time money got acquired, they will have higher chance of getting cancer compared to a healthy user. That led him to get the Nobel Prize. And then in the era of everybody trying cancer vaccines, viruses, everything possible people trying to kill the cancer, but finally all failed. In the clinic, in the laboratory animal settings, they survived or they showed that their drugs work, but in the clinic, most of them or majority of them failed. And then came these people, Allison and Tony, who did something different to save us or to save the many cancer patients. So what was happening? What are the different avenues of cancer immunotherapy? So everybody, as I said, trying to boost the immune system. They are trying to activate the immune responses either by tumor-specific antibodies, cytokines, cell therapy, adoptive cell transfer. So these are considered passive immunotherapy or active immunotherapy. So there was almost 70-80 years gone in trying different molecules to boost the immune system. But here comes something different by these two gentlemen, Jim Allison and Rafuku, who identified basically a protein or set of proteins that act as a break. And what are these breaks? So these are the main important discoveries. You have take home message in one line. You can take this message that Allison and Rafuku discovered the immune system break. What stopped the immune system to function. So what are these breaks? These breaks are in the form of certain proteins. So, Jim Allison, he worked on a protein called CTLA-4, cytotoxic T lymphocyte activation antigen, 4 and Rafuku Honio, and he discovered a protein called PD-1, program death 1. In fact, as the previous speaker was mentioning, this time something very unique in the Nobel Prize. One thing is, Nobel Prizes are going to the application rather than the product discovery. So CTLA-4 actually protein was discovered by Arlene Sharp at Harvard, but how to use this protein to cure the cancer, this concept was used by Jim Allison, and he got the Nobel Prize just to use this protein blocking this protein and saving the patient. And Rafuku Honio, he discovered the PD-1 and also discovered that how to block this protein. So how these proteins work. So how we identify that these are the brain. So here you think about a cancer cell or an immune cell. So these are the main army of the immune system or T cell, T lymphocytes. These are the army or these are the effector cells that kill the tumor. So these cells, they get accelerator or they get the break. So when they get the accelerating signal from the antigen presenting cell, so these are the, let's imagine one person has a cancer, so cancer antigen will be presented by these cells, because antigen presenting cells, they will present the cancer to these cells. And once they present the cancer to these cells, or T cells, they get activated and they kill the cancer cell. However, now these people discovered cancer cells have a brain. So when these cancer cells come and present the antigen to T cells, rather than having acceleration, they also give them the brain. And this is something unique which everybody was missing. Everybody was focusing that giving acceleration to the car will move forward. However, everybody was missing that brakes are on. So you have to release the brake if you want to move the car. The same thing that Rafuku Honio, he discovered similar proteins, PD-1. There are other proteins, other brakes are also being discovered for LAG-3 and others. But similar, exactly identical concept here. You have the antigen presenting cells, which is presenting cancer to the T cell get activated, kill the cancer. But again, cancer cells are having the brake on them. So when they need this immune effector cells, they brake. So these our immune cells don't function. And this idea actually originated from the placent sample, when these B cells from the placent were taken out in the laboratory, the scientists were thinking that maybe these cells in the placent are defective, and that's why they don't function. So they take out these T cells from the placent, bring them into the lab, and now they put them together with the cancer cell. What they found, that these cells, when they put in the cancer cell, they kill them. But same cells, well, when it's present in the patient, they are not killed. So this comes that means these cells are not defective. Something in the cancer, in these patients, that causing them or making them defective. And that was the discovery of these breaks, which are present in the patient cancer, which is causing these T cells not function. Right? So here I have this example, here where everybody was thinking that this is a car where accelerator you put it, but you must get off from the brake. Then only car will move. But if no matter how much gas pedal you press, if you another foot is on the brake, car is not going to move. And this exact technique, what Jim Allison has done. As I said, Jim Allison did not discover the CTLA-4, but what he did, as Kiran was mentioning, he first displayed acne, his lab actually made the antibody against CTLA-4. And this anti-CTLA-4 antibody, he gave to these mice, which are having the tumor. So tumor-bearing mice were given an antibody against these different proteins. So Jim Allison did experiment with anti-CTLA-4 antibody. So the protein was CTLA-4. If you have to block this protein, you have to get an antibody against this protein. And that's what Jim Allison has made. And Dr. Su Gohoyo, he did anti-PD-1 antibody in the lab. And what they did, they injected this antibody into the mouse, which is having tumor, and checked the tumor growth. So on the y-axis of this plot, what you see is the tumor size. On the x-axis, you see the time. So he gave the antibody, let's say, on the day 5 or day 10. And then what you see is three different groups. So one group got just nothing, right? So this is the plain line. And this is the main thing that you have to focus, the bottom one, where the mice that received the anti-CTLA-4 antibody, mice did not develop a tumor. This was the first experiment which we have done in 1996, showing that if you block the immune inhibition, the immune negative regulation, you can cure the mice. Similar experiment was done in 2005 by using this Tasuko's lab, when they used anti-PD-1 antibody. The mice were treated now with anti-PD-1 antibody. And what you see here, that mice that receive the antibody, they have a smaller tumor compared to the mice that did not receive, suggesting that both concepts, they work, at least in the laboratory setting. And then comes the clinical results. So then there are multiple clinical trials were made, and that was the discovery of Yervoy from Bristol Myers Squibb, and then Opivo, which is a drug from the anti-PD-1. And these two drugs, first of course, the CTLA-4 was discovered in 2011 with a clinical improvement. And then 2014-15, anti-PD-1 came to the market. And the results were excellent, because then after even 4 months, this published in the New England Journal of Medicine in 2012, suggesting that tumor is completely gone. But just to share with you one little story, when this was first time this data of clinical efficacy came around 2008-2009, mathematical statistical significance was that median age of the person who can be saved by these drugs only enhanced by 3 months. So if you see the original publication, that's it, only 3 months age is enhanced compared to no treatment. So everybody criticized it, because that's what the mathematics, the statistical, and sometimes in biology, mathematics and biology go in parallel, but sometimes you have to be careful when you're analyzing your data. What was missing that this drug actually works in few patients, it doesn't work in all. So those who are responders to this drug, they get benefit even up to the 8. Those who don't get, they don't have any response. So when you do this mathematics, statistics, you mix everything. Right? So in biology, that's the message that I want to give to especially the students. That when you are analyzing the data, you have to make sure that you are taking the responders versus non-responders and then analyze the data. And then describe. So that time, I still remember one of my lab meetings at Harvard where somebody criticized that this is only 3 months, it's of no use. It's because this costs very high. And then other person said, you don't know what you're talking about. So, but anyway, so the other thing is that now very recent data came in 2017. The clinical data came in 2017. What it says that what they have done, they use the drug of both the scientists, Jim Allison, anti-CTLA-4 and anti-PD-1 together to the large number of patients and they analyze them. What you see here, even more than 60% of the patients on the y-axis, what you see is the survival, and on the x-axis is the time after the thing. And then what you are seeing here, the more than 60% patients are alive even after 3 years. So here we have 58% nivolumab and ipilimumab, which is a PD-1 and CTLA-4. And when they are alone, they have some response, but both together, they have very good response. Suggesting that still we do not know, how to stratify the patient. That means who to give, who do not need to give. We do not know those questions, those answers yet. The reason is that, and why we don't know, because there was one biomarker that people think that if a person's tumor has CTLA-4 expressor or PD-1 expressor, they would be likely to get benefit from these antibodies. But there are cases when they did not see these markers expressed on the tumor, but those patients still respond to these drugs, which is very surprising that you don't have these markers on the cancer cell, then where the break coming from? Right? How this works in those patients who don't even have this expressor. Then there are more signs towards it, and they said these receptors are expressed more on myeloid cells compared to cancer cells, which act as a brake. So until today, we do not stratify the patient based on any marker. So these drugs are in everybody, and all patients are eligible to it. We do not know which one will get benefit and which one we don't get benefit. But the bottom line is, this really, really works. And it works in many, many patients, many, many different types of tumor. Okay? So what inspired them to their research? They, of course, published in Nature, PNAS, and many different journals. So Jim Allison was, I think, luckier than Kasuko, because Kasuko published a very small journal of his work. But Jim Allison, of course, is from the Memorial Sloan, so he published, I think, very, very high-impact journal. But what was inspiring, of course, the family history, where he mentioned that his mother was actually dying of lymphoma when he was very early as a kid. And always, it was always in the back of his mind that he wanted to explore the role of T cells, which are the, which I was saying, is the immune cells, the most important cells in the immunology, in the immune system. But these are the cells which are the major factor cell types in the anti-tumor immune response. Similarly, Kasuku, he began his research in the medical school when his classmate actually died of his stomach cancer, and that's the time he decided that he was to work on the cancer immunology and wanted to save many lives. And in fact, and this is the paper I was talking about when he published International Immunology, a very regular journal in the field of immunology. Of course, he published many good journals as well, but the first work was not recognized as high as Jim Allison. So, if I summarize it, if in summary I would like to say that discovery of immune brake, they saved thousands of lives, and this is one of those drugs in the field of cancer that treat multiple different types of tumor, not only just one tumor. So it's personalized, but not too much personalized, because it can treat many different types of humor. So far, only area is not know who to treat or who will respond. So Alim Shah, who actually was the discoverer of PPL report, he was also, I think, write very nicely that not all patients respond to this, but for the ones that do, it has made a huge difference in their lives. There are patients over a decade ago who had incredibly poor prognosis, and now, a decade out, they are living normal lives. So, and also, some of you might have heard that US President Jimmy Carter, who was last 2015 diagnosed with the lung cancer, but which had a melanoma basically that moved to the brain, he treated with Trastuzumab medicine and anti-PD-1, and now he's under remission. So with this, I will stop here, and thank you so much for your time.
I have no background in this. I am only curious. Now this concern leads me to ask, is there any help in treating HIV? For instance, are there breaks in HIV? Is there a difference between clinic and the field trials? And is there a similarity? So can we learn something in treating HIV from this?
I think a very good question, that people actually are trying this break in HIV as well. Because I think putting those breaks from the HIV can also have some impact. But problem with the HIV is, it actually harbors in the cells of the immune system only, especially the T cells. So when it harbors and use them as a factory, T cells basically die. So the problem is little bit different, but I know that there are some trials going on with anti-PD-1 and anti-CTLA-4.
Is this, you said it's applicable for different types of cancers. So has it been tried on liver cancer or colon cancers? And is this type of medicine available in India?
So in colon cancer, yes. Liver cancer, I'm not sure about. And the second question is, vaccine available in India? Yes, it is available, but again, very, very expensive. So it's available via these companies only. There's no generic right now. That's the reason why it is very expensive.